3.
A live podcast sponsored by the Marin Fire History Group. All about the history of the fire service in Marin County, California. And now your host, retired Fire Chief Bill Lewis.
Well, good day, and welcome to the Marin County Fire Chief's historical website. We had the privilege to be at the San Rafael Fire Department in San Rafael, California, to introduce you to a restoration project that is about to begin. Normally, we show you a finished product that took years in the making. Today is very unique. We're going to show you one that has just begun. This is a 1938 quad, which means it carries 4 operational procedures. It carries a pump, carries water, carries hose, and carries a complement of ladders, probably over 200 feet of total ladders are on this apparatus. This is a very, very unique piece of apparatus. From 1935 to 1940, American LaFrance built this 4 series. It's called a 4 series, and they only built 140 of them. And only one came to California as a display model, and this is it. This is the only 1938 in California, and they only made 140 of them from 1935 to 1940. American LaFrance added numbers and letters to their model numbers, and the 4 series was from 35 to 40. They were all positive displacement pumps, and it's what we now call a Class B pumper. Until 1945, this had to make capacity when it pumped. It had to pump 750 gallons a minute at 20 pounds. And in 1945, the National Board of Firefighters, because of the power plants, the motors were getting so powerful, they upped the capacity of the pressure. So the new engines are called Class A's, and they pump their capacities at 150 psi, all within a range of the maximum RPM of the engine. So today, we have the privilege to have a gentleman who has driven this apparatus, and it's going to walk us around it and explain it to us. And he is Battalion Chief Pete Davis, and I'd like to introduce him now.
Hey, good morning. Thank you for having me and being part of the narration for this fine piece of apparatus. Chief Lewis and Chief Smith have been working on getting this captured for a long time. I was on a short list of people they thought could help, and I actually ended up being on a shorter list of people that have actually driven this piece of apparatus. I started my career in the fire service in 1982, came to San Rafael in 1985, and was assigned to Engine 3 on Joseph Court. At the time, sitting next to the engine company was the 1938 City Service Ladder Truck. As long as I have been around, it has always been referred to as the City Service Ladder Truck. It was an honor to drive it. I'm not going to say it was fun, because it was challenging. It has a square tooth von synchronized transmission. It turns around in about 3 city blocks. And at the time when they called up in the morning and said it needs to go to the Little League parade, I was the guy that drove it. I drove it 3 times, twice in the Dixie Little League parade and once in the San Rafael Little League parade. We're going to go around and look at some of the features of the quad and the things it had to offer. It was state of the art at the time. As the chief said, it came to California as a demo piece. And over the years, people passed along a lot of the information that at this point you could say is hearsay because no one actually knew some of the things about it. But as a piece of apparatus in that time, 86 years ago, it was the best. And for a ladder truck combination with a pump and hose, it actually served a relatively short time on the streets of San Rafael because of a fire that occurred in 1957. At that time, there was a major fire in downtown San Rafael that destroyed 19 businesses. And one of the things that came out of that fire is San Rafael ordered a 1958 100-foot midship ladder truck that eventually replaced this piece of apparatus. So when this was delivered in a demo, it was said that it cost $13,000 at the time to purchase it. And as we go around, we'll look at some of the features of this fine piece of apparatus.
Chief, can you explain what looks like a very powerful engine that drives its apparatus?
Yeah, so as we look at the engine compartment here, you'll notice that the top here is American LaFrance. Back in the day, American LaFrance made these motors. This is a 12-cylinder gasoline engine, and it's been said to have 280 horsepower. As you can see, it's very simple to look at and simple to check, but there's no dipsticks. It's all done with bolts and things like that. But at the time, American LaFrance made all their own engines.
Chief, can we talk about that unique cam siren and its history?
Sure. Sure. So the cam siren here that's mounted on the side here is a mechanical siren. And one of the interesting features of this siren is they were all manufactured in Ross, California. And, very old, very unique, and today the mechanical siren is still one of those things that when you're going down the road, gets your attention that there is a fire apparatus coming up behind you.
Chief, how do you know the capacity of this pump?
So when we talked about the numbers, and fire apparatus always have numbers attached to them, this was a Series 400. As it was talked about, is a 475, 75 being the GPM of this pump. It was a 750 gallon per minute pump, which was actually pretty significant at the time. And as in today's apparatus, you can always go around and count to 2.5 discharges on any apparatus to know that will equate to 250 gallons per minute by how many discharges there is the volume of that pump. So here we have two on this side and we have one on the other side. One of the unique features about this apparatus is the gauges, the transfer from the road to pump, and the other discharge are all on the officer's side of this apparatus.
Chief, I noticed the length of these two pipe holes. They're incredible length. I guess the ceilings must have been quite high in the old days.
So yes, back in the day, San Rafael was a thriving city north of San Francisco, and there was a lot of Victorians built. Well, the Victorians at that time had high ceilings, so in order to peel down the lath and plaster from the ceiling, they had to have large pipe holes in order to do that. The other part of this apparatus in the 475, which we talked about, is the RBV, and that is it's a rotary gear pump, but it has two banks of ground ladders, and that's what that stood for. The other unique feature of this is the wide side running boards, and there is a very unique video on the fire chief's website of the 1957 fire that I encourage everyone to watch. But there's also some steel pictures of this apparatus going down the street. And I will stand up here and demonstrate that because of the wide board, the firefighters rode like this And there's pictures of them hanging on to the ground ladder. Back in the day, there were no safety belts. When you rode down the streets, you held on, and that's how they traveled on this apparatus. Okay, so with this apparatus, with the double bank of ground ladders, which makes up one of the aspects of it being a quad, the wooden ladders, all made by American LaFrance at the time, came with this apparatus, but they had locks on them. So there's one here, and there's one on the back right corner, and to release the ground ladder, you just flip this lever up, which made them able to be released and come off the back of the apparatus. And that locked them into place.
So just basically looking at the size of these ladders, when you pull up to an incident, you had to leave a lot of room behind you.
Absolutely a lot of room. And sure. So these are drafting hoses, and the size of these hoses are all put with the apparatus based on the pump classification. So today's drafting hoses, you'll see, are sometimes a little bit bigger, 5-6 inches for the larger capacity pumps. These are made to take from a static source of water, whether it's on the side of a pier, whether it's on a bridge down to a water source, a swimming pool, or a portable pump. These were outfitted with every apparatus during this time era and came with them. So you did have the option to draft with these pumps.
Good. I notice there's no fog nozzles on the apparatus.
Yeah, that is correct. Because back in the time, all smooth bore nozzles were used to fight fires. These are actually Akron nozzles with a smooth brass nozzle. And that's how fires were put out during that time. The invention of the combination fog nozzle had not yet been introduced to the fire service.
So each of those nozzles, I see there's like a stack. I assume each nozzle flows at, 50 pounds of pressure?
Yes, that's exactly correct. And these are rated for what we at the time called working line, or 2.5-inch hose lines. And that was the same as the hydrant lines, which when we get to the back, we'll show you where the hose was held. But these you could break off and put different size tips on them if you needed to, or take the tip off to get as much flow out of these as you could.
Yeah. Chief, can you explain these ladders? They look like ladders, but they look quite different than some today's modern aluminum ladders.
Yeah, absolutely. At the time, back in the 30s, ground ladders were all made out of wood. American LaFrance, as you see the stamps on the side of them, just like the engine, engine that they produce, they made their own ground ladders. This is what they call a double bank of ground ladders. This is a 30 double extension. There's a 24 flat ladder, a 10, a 20 there. And this is the old hook ladders here, flat ladder, that you'd hang off the top of a roof. Basically what we call a roof ladder these days. But the ladders these days have hooks that you could turn and poke out. This is one where they are fixed, which is why the hooks are facing outright here.
Oh, and I see we have another release with the ladder.
Yeah, we have another release for the ladders. And in the back here, down below, this is an old life net. Back in the day, people jumping out of windows, there's an old life net in here.
Oh.
And this came standard with ladder trucks at the time. I don't know when the last time this was pulled out, but it's been in there for a long time. And this was standard equipment that came with these trucks.
In the old fashioned, you get around all the guys holding it.
Exactly.
Inside the window.
Exactly.
Wow.
So there's a little bit of history right there.
But we know it looks like it could hold a lot of holes.
Oh, yeah. The bin up here runs up to about the middle of the truck there. And we didn't touch on it, but one of the factors that makes this a quad is it does have a water tank on it.
Yeah.
One of the features that is up on top has a hose reel, and of course, two bins for the 2.5 hose. That was very
bouncing of water, about 160 gallons in those things.
I think it's actually about 100 gallon tank.
Wow.
Yes.
Today, I think I've been on the floor.
Yeah. So looking around here, here's a rather hard suction hose that every apparatus at the time came with two pieces, which would give it a 20-foot lift out of a body of water. Of course, a company like this always had a lot of ground ladders and a lot of tools, had a lot of things for forcible entry. And if you go around here, you'll see a lot of axes, a lot of pry bars, and a lot of different things that were, well, a truck company's tools at the time.
And that's, I think, a very unique way to pull holes at this. It's really, really smooth, cool.
Yeah, so when you come up to a fire hydrant, fire apparatus these days, it shoots straight off the bat. This came off the sides to keep the hose away from the ground ladder, so when they were laying hose out, if there was a group of people coming back to get ground ladders, they did not have to fight with that. So that was a kind of a unique feature for this apparatus. And again, as I alluded to, you see the keep back 300 feet on the back of this apparatus.
Big long pipe poles again.
Yep, long pipe poles.
The extinguishers look a little different than today's.
Yeah, the extinguishers are different. We have a CO2, we have a water extinguisher. And if you look at this, it's got some different things on it. It's got some things to either pressurize it at the time or open the pressure. I'm not sure exactly how this is. And this one actually, this stamped SRFD, but it's got a long hose and very different than the water extinguishers you see today.
Chief, there seems to be a lot of equipment here.
Yeah.
To be able to use. Can you explain some of the stuff?
Sure.
I see who shovels.
Sure. So as we talked about on the other side, that the operation for this pump was done on the right side of the apparatus, completely contrary to today's modern apparatus. But there's a lot of things here. I got my pump gauges here. This is actually my one single 2.5 discharge that makes up the two on the other side for the 750 gallons. But this is reduced down to 1.5 inches. Up here, you can see this is our filler for a water tank. I'm thinking I've seen some things that it was 75 gallons. We're estimating this is probably around 100 gallons just based on the tank here. Comes down, drops into the pump here. This is modern day what we would call our engineer's compartment. This is where the engineer has his fittings. Some of the things that are not seen too much these days, although most truck companies carry these, are hay hooks and things like that. You can see we have Halligan tools or some form of that, scoop shovels, all the things you would need to be a functioning truck company to take care of what they call any task that comes around. As the operation of the engineer is here, here's our lever from our road to pump, which gets shifted here outside the apparatus where today they're all electronic and they get done in the cab. Back there was a spotlight, another spotlight here. A lot of things of lighting was very important back then, because one, there was a lack of street lights. And the other thing is, when you got to a fire, you had to light it up to see what you were dealing with.
So, Chief, I see we have a couple gauges right above the number 5 and on the pump, and what looks like maybe an external throttle.
Yeah.
And you talked about those.
Yeah, that's correct. So this is an old-style external throttle to run the RPMs of the pump up, because you'd be in pump on the outside here. These are the two gauges that are synonymous today with every engine that comes out on the street, and they are a pressure gauge and a compound gauge. This being the pressure gauge, that when you're throttling up your RPMs, that you would see how much pressure your pump is putting out. On the other side, if you deployed your black suction hose into a body of water and you were going to draft, this drops down on a negative side into inches of mercury from 0 to 30. So when you were drafting and pulling a prime, this would drop down and show you how much pressure you are creating within the interior of that pump. These are still the exact same gauges that are on every apparatus that is still on the street today.
So on the pressure gauge, and if you had multiple lines out on the discharges, the engineer would be the most friction loss, and then it had to gate down the other one because they didn't have a gauge for each.
Yes, yeah, that is correct. So this gauge ran all three of the discharges, where today you have you can do it all with different gauges and set everything differently, throttle down, open up, things like this. This was the only pressure gauge you had. And this was a little light here. The thing's been broken off, but this is a little light bulb in here that illuminated this at night.
Chief, can you, this being a 80-some years old, 86-year-old, I imagine you had the power steering was really in the arms of the drivers compared to today's.
Yeah, and some of the things that, you know, we talk about changes, we talk about things that have advanced in technology and things like that. When I go across this panel here, not a lot of this has changed.
Yeah.
This is an open cab apparatus at the time. You had one windshield wiper for the driver. The officer, he didn't get a windshield wiper. And as we go across, it's your standard gauges for any type of engine. The same today. We have our water temperature. We have amps. We have gas. We have our speedometer with our mileage. This has 4,196 miles on it. We have our tachometer, which the gauge is gone. So I guess you don't have to worry about that. And then over here, we have the oil pressure. We have the battery switches. Looking down here, we got the brake. And then this is the four-speed transmission. And it says where you flip the thing over to lock this in before you come out and switch the gauge from road to pump. This had an automatic push-button starter right there to the right of the floor pedal.
Were there multiple ways of starting the engine? Did you have a battery crank?
Yeah, you have a battery here. You got to turn the batteries on, send battery to it, and press the starter. This rig, actually, if you saw it in the front, it has a crank, too, to turn it over. So
I can't imagine that.
Yeah.
If it decided not to work.
Exactly.
Very good. Very nice. Go ahead and judge you. Is that the crank coming up?
Yeah, so right here, this is a crank for the motor. I'm pretty sure if we went through there and looked, we could find the crank for this.
Oh.
Obviously, to crank this engine over would have a lot of torque, and you have to be really careful for things. These things also. One of the things we didn't touch on is back in 1938, when this got introduced in the 400 series that came out here to the West Coast, this was called the Cattle Guard. And this was the first attempt by American LaFrance to make this a flashy-looking fire apparatus. And this is what they did with the front cattle guard, they called it at the time.
Protection in front of a train.
Yeah.
I will say one thing, that this was the 400 series was the last where the engine was in front of the cab. The 500 series, American LaFrance was, you sat over the edge. And that was a really significant change in the length of the truck, the steering radius, round curves. You put your cab, your seat, and stuff right on the top.
Well, there's a little bit of trivia for you.
Yeah. Yeah. So, Chief, we want to thank you so much for the tour. Anything you want to say?
Well, yeah. First of all, I wanted to thank you guys because you're preserving the history of the fire service, especially for Marin County. And it's my honor to be here and help narrate some of these things for you. I just wanted to let everyone know there are a lot of videos on the Marin County's Fire Chief's historical site, and your efforts to preserve the history of this career is not only admirable, but it's one of these things that hopefully people get a lot of enjoyment out of it over the years to come. And thank you again. This was my pleasure.
All right. Thank you.